Okay, I'm here with my APPE student, and we're going to go over GI pharmacology, working on a new book. I got inspired to do some things that are more visual. You know that I'm all about the suffixes and prefixes, so we'll include those. But I want to go through quickly what it is that we're trying to do and try to make more of a visual, more kinesthetic way of approaching pharmacology. So I'll show you what I have on the board. And what we're going to do is we're going to go through the classes, antacids, H2 blockers, PPIs, gastric protectants, motility agents, a little bit about H. pylori, which goes with the PPIs here. And then we paired a couple of different pathophysiologic classes, diarrhea with constipation, nausea with vomiting, irritable bowel syndrome, and irritable bowel disease. And normally on a YouTube video, you have somebody who's a really good artist and they're drawing what is amazing and it helps you remember it. Our goal is to not draw it necessarily for you, but to help you draw it for yourself. Because they show that if you teach someone else, it's about 90% retention. So the idea is if you can replicate this, then you can learn this probably the best way possible. And so we'll start with the antacids. I just alphabetize them because there's no real relationship that's necessarily too big between them. Aluminum hydroxide, calcium carbonate, both of them have to do, you can both get constipation from both of them. You can both get, deal with phosphate binding as well, so hyperphosphatemia. But that just is a coincidence that those two are together. And then you put the brand name. Now I know on the NCLEX for the nurses, you only need the generic name, but a lot of people remember things, brand name first and then the generic. So, and then patients use brand names, so I always recommend still trying to learn the brand names. So aluminum hydroxide is Amphagel. Calcium carbonate, this is Tums, and also the active ingredient in children's Pepto. So again, Pepto-Bismol for adults is that liquid, and the children's Pepto is a tablet that's a little bit counterintuitive. Usually the children's is the liquid. Magnesium hydroxide, this is milk of magnesia. And this, unlike these two which cause constipation, this one has a laxative effect and is often used as a laxative. And then sodium bicarbonate is so old, I couldn't even find a brand name for it. But there's some issues with alkalosis and things like that. Okay, so we start with the antacids and we put them on the top of what I call this fishbowl. And the fishbowl is meant to show you how these relate. And antacids you use after you have a meal. So think of this rise in, I guess you would call it liquid or acid, as something that happens after you eat. So antacids you use 1 to 3 hours after a meal. Okay. H2 blockers and PPIs are actually meant to suppress acid. So I put them above the acid. And the H2 blockers, again, we remember that those end in tidine, T-I-D-I-N-E. And we think of maybe a dining room table and that people are going to dine, because after you dine, then it's when the acid problems come, the reflux and so forth. I put these in alphabetical order as well. And the nice thing is that the oldest ends up first, cimetidine. And this is the one that has those P450 interactions. We don't really see it too much in clinical practice anymore. But cimetidine, famotidine, nizatidine, ranitidine, Tagamet, Pepcid, Axid, and Zantac. And I'm not going to go over the mnemonics right now for the words. You can find those in other videos I've made. But the goal is to see everything visually and together. So most of the time, somebody would try an antacid first, then they would go to an H2 blocker, and then they would go to a PPI. So now we have a proton pump inhibitor. Again, we have our prazole ending. Be careful again with this. It's not azole. Azole is a type of organic chemistry compound because there's fluconazole, which is an antifungal. There's aripiprazole, which is for certain schizophrenia, things like that. So what we want is to make sure we have the right ending. So prazole, and then we have six of these, and I just put them alphabetically. Dexlansoprazole, esomeprazole, omeprazole, lansoprazole, pantoprazole, and rabeprazole. And you say, how do you remember all of that? Well, lansoprazole and dexlansoprazole are related. esomeprazole and omeprazole are related, and then pantoprazole and rabeprazole are just two that we add on there. So again, look to the other videos for the mnemonics for these brand names. Good Night Pharm, Memorizing Pharmacology. But what we're trying to do is say, okay, well, let's, in relation to the antacids and H2 blockers, where do PPIs come in? And these take a bit longer to work, but we're looking at a proton pump. We're stopping those protons, those hydrogen ions, from getting into the stomach and causing that additional acidity. Okay, so then we're going to kind of pan over a little bit. So this H. pylori is helicopter-like shaped bacteria, and I put a helicopter in there. And what I did was I said, okay, well, just think of what my kids would do. My kids are 6 years old, and they would throw a helicopter into a fishbowl, not blink. And so we're going to say, well, what do we need to do to get rid of this helicopter? And there's right now triple therapy, quadruple therapy. There are many different combinations, but I thought it was important with the new book that I'm writing to start with the old book. I didn't want to mix drug classes. So if it was GI, I kept it in GI. But this is really getting into immune. And if you're studying for the licensing board, the NCLEX, NAPLEX, the USMLE, you want to start using these antibiotics. So amoxicillin, again, the cillin stem, is a penicillin antibiotic. Clarithromycin. This throw is sort of a substem. Mycin tells you it's from the streptomyces class. But again, we've got two different drugs, so we're trying to prevent resistance, and we're trying to lower dosages of each drug individually. And then we could have used any of the PPIs. I just put esomeprazole because amoxicillin, clarithromycin, esomeprazole spells ACE. So I thought just triple ACE. That's one way of attacking H. pylori. But in the Midwest, I'm in Iowa, we have a lot of trouble with clarithromycin resistance. So because of this clarithromycin resistance, we think, okay, well, maybe we'll need to use the quad, which is to use four different drugs. And I thought, well, when you get to bed after a meal, then that acidity starts to come up, especially if it's a duodenal ulcer. And so I put BEDM as a way to remember all of the drugs. So bismuth subsalicylate from the Pepto-Bismol, esomeprazole, which is Nexium, doxycycline, a tetracycline antibiotic, which is brand vibramycin, and metronidazole or metronidazole, which is brand Flagyl. Okay, so again, we have an acid, something to reduce the acid, and three to attack the antibiotic. And again, what we're doing now is we're including other drug classes to make sure that we have an understanding of mechanisms, how we treat, and so we're kind of going a little bit from pharmacology to pharmacology and therapeutics. Okay? So now we come back over here, and so we've looked at the H. pylori. If that helicopter is missing, okay, and we still have an ulcer, it's probably an NSAID-induced ulcer. Okay? So the ibuprofens, the naproxens, the meloxicams, and what we're going to use in that case is probably a gastric protectant of one kind or another. And so I put them down here. We have sucralfate, which is carafate, and this is a pink liquid that really coats the stomach to protect against ulceration. But the one drug that's only approved for these NSAID-induced ulcers is this misoprostol, which is Cytotec. Okay, this is pregnancy category X. It's very dangerous to the fetus. We don't want to use it in that way. But again, what we're doing is we're saying, okay, we're at the bottom of the fishbowl, so we're thinking spatially, we're going to have something that protects the bottom of the fishbowl against this ulceration. And sucralfate and misoprostol are really, that's where they work. The last one we think about is a motility agent, and maybe you want to put some kind of opening or leak to the fishbowl, where metoclopramide is actually a motility agent that speeds the acid and gets it out of there faster. So rather than suppress the amount of acid, we're trying to get it out of there. There are some issues with metoclopramide, which is brand Reglan, that it, in some cases, has interactions with other drugs. But what we're trying to do with the fishbowl is say, okay, how do we spatially remember all of these drug classes? So then we are thinking, okay, the fishbowl is kind of the stomach. Now we're going down to the intestines with these other three pairs of drugs. Okay. So we'll start with diarrhea and constipation. And the way that we go from one drug to the next is severity. So the first thing you might do is just pull a bottle of Pepto off the shelf, bismuth subsalicylate, and say, okay, well, if that helps, great. The diarrhea went away. It was just some upset stomach. Maybe it's a little bit worse. Then you would use loperamide, which is brand Imodium, and you would take maybe a couple tablets. The way that it works is that you take two tablets the first time usually, and then one tablet after each bowel movement to a certain maximum. Okay. But let's say it still hasn't gone away, and we don't have any kind of a bacterial diarrhea, rather it's still, you know, we're still kind of idiopathic, we're not sure what it is. Then the physician or prescriber might give you diphenoxylate with atropine, which creates low motility or slows the bowel as well. But this is by prescription, and it also has a DEA drug class. Okay? So the atropine is there is so that someone doesn't crush it and inject it and abuse it. So again, these three drugs for diarrhea, bismuth, loperamide, diphenoxylate, are all in an order that says, okay, well, it's getting worse. This is our therapeutic steps. With constipation, we did the exact same thing. Okay, so just as where we went from bismuth to the opioid that's over the counter, and when I say opioid, it's non-addicting, it just has a kind of an opioid agonist effect, and then a little bit more with the prescription version. So we, again, kind of going up the ladder. We're going to start with something that's bulk-forming, but psyllium, it's really just fiber, so what we're doing is we're just adding that fiber that's completely absent in the American diet. Then if that doesn't work, then maybe we use a stool softener. And if that doesn't work, maybe we use a stimulant. We can combine these two to have the stool softener and stimulant, and then maybe an osmotic, and these are completely different. But let me go through the four in order. So the psyllium is Metamucil, and it comes in a very large, kind of a circular tube thing. And the way that I think of these is I think of this large tube first, then the DocuSafe bottle, then the Senna box, and then the cap of the Miralax. So it goes down physically in my mind when I'm thinking about it. And so this is bulk forming, and it's just trying to make you really more regular by giving you something that's missing from your diet. This DocuSafe sodium or colase is going to pull water into the bowel, so you do want to take it with water, not because you want the pill to go down easier, but because you're going to be pulling water and you want to make sure that the patient isn't dehydrated. This you usually see with something like an opioid, like a Percocet or something like that, because those are very constipating. Senna is something that gets things moving quite a bit. It's called a stimulant, and so we can either use this alone or add them together to get more of a stimulant effect. And then polyethylene glycol has two extremes. You have Miralax, which is this very gentle cap full of medicine that you can get over the counter. And then you've got Go Lightly, and there is nothing lightly about this. It's a gallon jug, and it's meant for bowel prep. So polyethylene glycol, depending how you use it, is one of these osmotics that either has a very gentle way of doing things or a very severe way of doing things. So again, we're thinking therapeutically, what's the next thing, what's the next thing, what's the next thing? Okay. With nausea and vomiting, what we have is we're going to have another kind of therapeutic triad here, where we're going to start with these 5-HT3s. So the citron, again, is the stem for ondansetron, palonosetron. The Zofran, this one is PO, aloxy is IV. And these 5-HT3s are meant to prevent especially chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting. It's used for other things, but the idea was that if we can stop the brain from wanting to vomit, then we can help these patients that are on chemotherapy who are already weak to begin with. If this doesn't work by itself, a lot of times we add dexamethasone, which is a corticosteroid. In the book, this is actually in respiratory section. So again, what we're doing is we're kind of going in this advanced version to other chapters that we already know, because for someone that's studying for the boards, they'll know what dexamethasone is. And while sone isn't a stem, it's something that you'll see in a lot of the steroids. Okay? Then if we have something like delayed emesis, where it just happens a bit later, we might use aprepitant or fosaprepitant with a pitant stem, and these are NK1s. I'm not sure how they both have the same brand name. I've never seen that, but that's what I see. And because I'm community pharmacy, I don't really see these two drugs in my personal practice. Okay? So for nausea and preventing nausea, we can start here with the 8,5-HT3, then we can add a corticosteroid, and then the NK1, and this is all trying to prevent something from happening. If someone is actively vomiting, and you can see where the arrow goes, because unfortunately that's where these drugs are going to end up, both Compazine and Phenergan have suppository forms, and these are both phenothiazines. Right? And because they have suppository forms, it allows us to help someone who's actively vomiting who wouldn't be able to take a pill or something like that. Okay? IBS and IBD, this usually ends up at the end of most chapters or most at the end of sections, because when we start thinking about the board exams, we want to think high yield. And we'll definitely be using high yield when we're thinking about proton pump inhibitors and gastroesophageal reflux disease and things like peptic ulcer disease. But IBS and IBD, while IBS is prevalent and it happens a lot, we don't necessarily see that as much on the board exams. But something like lubiprostone or emetiza, this is a C2 chloride channel activator. I don't know if you'll have to know that depending on your exam. But the idea is that we're going to be dealing with a condition that is just an irregularity. Sometimes you have diarrhea, sometimes you have constipation. We're trying to regulate that. With infliximab, we have irritable bowel disease, which is an autoimmune condition. And so what we want to do, just like we contrasted diarrhea and constipation as opposites, nausea and vomiting is happening at, the treatment's happening at opposite parts of the body. The syndrome versus the disease, this is much, much more severe. And because we have an autoimmune disease, we're going to use something like a biologic like infliximab. So again, these endings are, this is a substem, this is a substem, and this says it's a monoclonal antibody. And whether you have to know these substems depends on your board exam, but knowing them allows you to know, okay, well, was it humanized, was it chimeric, was it human, and all of these things that kind of give you some extra details. But this is a remission aid, where the brand name Remicade comes from. And the idea with irritable bowel disease is that if the body is attacking itself, then we want to shut down the immune system a little bit so that we prevent it from hurting itself. Okay. So again, this is a summary of GI, kind of the direction I'm going with a new book, trying to get you a lot more to see things visually. The analogy that I want to use is, while you might not know where exactly where the states are in the country and the United States, and you might not know exact shapes of them, if you put Florida down here with an orange, and you put California over here with maybe like Hollywood or something like that, and New York over here with Statue of Liberty, you know a lot about those places, or you start gathering memories from those places. So the idea is that on a board exam where you can't go back, you have to know the answer right there because you're forced to go to the next question. You need to use visuals to get that answer right away and to get it correctly right away. Okay, hope this helped.